was lost, I was in chains. The world had a hold of me. My heart was a stone, I was covered in shame. When he came for me, I couldn't run from his presence. I couldn't run from his arms. Jesus, he loves me, he loves me.
Hubley. I'm the interim pastor at the First Baptist Church in Sanbenton, New Hampshire, and thank you for joining me this morning. One of my favorite scriptures is from Proverbs 3, 5 through 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not in your own understanding, but in all ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. And another one is from Romans, that we know that in all things God works for good, for those who love him and are called according to his purposes. And I just share with you those this morning with the times that we are in. I think they are just so significant. I want to invite us to have a little time of prayer, and then I'm going to share a message that God has put on my heart this morning. So let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you that you are our Heavenly Father. You are our Abba, our Daddy, and there is nothing in this entire world that can separate us from the love that you have for us in Christ Jesus. And God, with everything that is going on in our world, in our country, everything just seems to be out of control. We know that you are in control, that God, you have a plan, that you are the King of Kings, that we can trust you completely. Father, we thank you for this time to gather together and to look into your word, your word that is a light unto our path and a light lamp unto our feet. God, I pray that you would speak to us this morning a fresh word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The title of my message this morning is called The Most Excellent Way, and it is from a very familiar passage, 1 Corinthians 13. And the really good thing about this morning's scripture passage is that many of us know it and are familiar with it. And the challenging thing about this morning's scripture passage is that many of us know it and many of us are familiar with it. Many of us have heard it in church, we've heard it at weddings, sometimes we do hear it at funerals and memorial services. And the challenge is that when we are so familiar with something, it is very natural to want to just kind of tune it out or not pay as much attention to it. Years ago, I remember complaining to someone that a particular store I was very used to going into had changed things around. They had changed the departments, they had changed the displays, and I was really frustrated because up until then, I was so used to just going, you know, putting the blinders on, and I would just go straight to the back of the store or wherever I needed to go to get my item. I knew where to go, and I just went for it. And that is when I learned that not only was it intentional, but it was a brilliant strategy to get you to notice other things in the store. And what happens? More often than not, when you get to the register, all of a sudden you have some extra goodies in your carriage that you had not planned on buying. Brilliant. Well, this morning, I hope with the help of Holy Spirit that you will see something you had not seen before in this very familiar passage, and that you will have something added to help you in your life as a believer. Because God's word, after all, is the living word of God. And every time we read it, every time we hear it, God has a fresh message for us. So as I read 1 Corinthians 13, if you have a Bible, I hope you'll read along. And maybe just a little prayer to the Lord before you hear this is just, you know, Lord, this is a passage we've heard so many times. Help us to hear it with fresh ears and just open up our hearts and our minds this morning and help us to learn something new that we can apply to our lives. And yet I will show you the most excellent way. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but have not love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains but not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love. May God bless the reading of these holy words. So this passage is a beautiful picture of what love is supposed to look like and what it is not supposed to look like. You know, as you know, it is often read at weddings, which is absolutely fine, but can I just tell you, the Apostle Paul was not writing to brides and grooms. He was writing to a church that had some issues. Well, of course they did. I've never known any church that didn't have struggles and issues because there is no church that is perfect. While Paul actually addressed one of those issues in chapter 12, the people in the church of Corinth were actually arguing over the spiritual gifts and which one they thought were most important. And that was hindering the work of Christ. It was hindering the spread of the gospel. Furthermore, the city of Corinth, the greatest trading and commercial center of the ancient world, was known for drunkenness and immoral behavior. And nearby was something called the Temple of Aphrodite, the goddess of love, which hosted approximately 1,000 priestesses, also known as sacred prostitutes. You know, just using those two words together is just incredibly disturbing. In the evening, these prostitutes would descend from the Acropolis, they would come into Corinth, and they would exercise their trade, if you will. So this is what's going on in Corinth. This is kind of the backdrop of why Paul is writing this. Paul knew the struggles that this church had, and so he writes this chapter to help them understand what love really is. You know, I think love is probably maybe one of the most misunderstood words that we have. Years ago, researchers asked the following question of some children who were between the ages of 4 and 8. What does love mean? The answers that they got were broader and deeper than anyone could have imagined. One little boy said, when someone loves you, the way they say your name is different. You know that your name is safe in their mouth. Another little boy said, love is what's in the room with you at Christmas if you stop opening presents and just listen. A little girl said, if you want to learn to love better, you should start with somebody you hate. There's a good one. One of the reasons that love, I think, is so misunderstood is that we use that word to describe so many different things. I love my sister. I love lobster. I love the fall season, and I love my country. You know, in the English language, the word love has a variety of meanings. Romantic or sexual love, friendship or affection, concern for the well-being of the other person, or just simple enthusiasm. I just love chocolate. The Greek language helped solve that problem by having three words for love. Eros, philos, and agape. Eros is romantic or sexual love. Philos is brotherly love, friendship, or companionship love. Agape is concerned for the well-being of other people. Agape is used over 253 times in the New Testament, and it is used for the kind of love that God has for his people and that we have for one another. So when Jesus says that the two most important commandments are love the Lord God and love your neighbor as yourself, he uses the word agape. And in this great love chapter, Paul uses the same word. Now remember, the church in Corinth is still very young and new, and so it is essential that the right teachings prevail so that the gospel of Christ can spread. So Paul starts his chapter, "Now I will show you the most excellent way." He then intentionally and very specifically brings out 5 spiritual gifts that people had elevated in the church as being the most important, and he shows their value if love is not present. So gift number 1, speaking in tongues. Paul doesn't even beat around the bush here. He says, you are a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal if you use this gift without love. Can I just tell you, this would have made complete sense to this church because back in the first century, there was a huge gong or cymbal hanging at the entrance to the pagan temples. And when people came to worship, they would hit the gong or cymbal to waken the pagan gods so they would listen to their prayers. So what is Paul really saying here? He's saying, even if you can speak with such eloquence, if there is no love behind your words, it is as ridiculous as pounding a gong to awaken a non-existent god. All right, that's pretty clear. Gift number 2. If you have the gift of prophecy and you can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, but do not have love, you are nothing. Now, this would have gotten the Corinthians' attention because, don't forget, they had a Greek heritage, which means that they highly prized philosophies and knowledge. Gift number three, if you have faith that can move mountains, but you do not have love, you are nothing. Let me give you an illustration of what Paul is talking about here. There was a man named Doug who had, I would say, the spiritual gift of faith, okay? And he felt called to go to India to be a missionary. While he was there, he got tuberculosis and he had to be put into a sanitarium. During that time, he tried to make the best of it by handing out tracts and Christian books. No one would take them. No one would listen to him. This started to affect his faith, and he really started to question, you know, I thought this is what I was supposed to do, and what's going on? Well, because he had tuberculosis, every night at 2 o'clock in the morning, he woke up with a chronic cough. And one night when he woke up, he noticed a man trying to get out of bed and go to the bathroom. But because the man was so weak, he never made it, thus making the staff angry because they had to clean up, and thus making the other patients make fun of him. One night, Doug woke up coughing, and with every ounce of strength that he could muster, he went over to this man, he picked him up, and he carried him to the bathroom. Guess what happened the next morning? The other patients all of a sudden wanted to read all the tracts and the books that Doug had, and they had questions about God and about his son. Doug then led many patients, doctors, and nurses to Christ. His faith was useless until people saw the love behind it. Gift number four, if I give all I possess to the poor but do not have love, I gain nothing. So here's the thing about giving. These are some questions we have to ask. What is our motive for giving? Is it because we feel guilty? Is it because we're trying to make ourselves look good? Are we trying to get something in return? Would we give if no one knew? If we give with ulterior motives behind the giving, then Paul's saying the love is missing and it's worthless. So our motive for giving must always be out of our love for God and our love for others. Finally, gift number five, Paul says that love is more important than sacrifices, martyrdom, or accomplishments. So even if we go to church every time the doors are open, we read our Bible faithfully, we serve, we make sacrifices, if there is no love behind it, then it is nothing in God's sight. So Paul makes it clear that the gifts they had felt were more important were actually useless unless there was love behind them. He then goes on and gets very specific about what love is and what love is not. And it's interesting to me how some people describe love. Maybe you've heard people say it this way. Have you ever heard someone describe love as something that just happens? They describe it like you fall in love, like you would fall into a ditch. Or you fall out of love, like you would fall out of a tree. It's like you can't help it. It's just something that happens to you. Well, that could not be more opposite to what the Bible teaches about love. Love is something that we choose to do. It is an action. It is a verb. It is not something that just happens. And then Paul goes on and describes the most excellent way in terms of eight things that it does and eight things that it does not. Now, I don't know about you, but when I first read this list, I find the list a little bit daunting. But instead of being overwhelmed with seeing how many areas I know that I need to work on, I want to just share with you something that I did this week. I don't think I've done this before, but I wrote this passage out and I put it in my prayer journal. And what I've decided to do over the next, it's probably going to be months, let's be honest, I'm going to ask God to help me to work on the areas that I clearly need to work on. It's just going to be part of my prayer time, if you will. So as we go through them together, I just want to encourage you to think about the relationships that you have in your life and maybe pay attention to the areas that Paul talks about that maybe you're doing really well at, and you can thank God for that. but maybe also ask the Lord to help you identify areas where you and the Lord can work together, because this is a really important list. So first, love is patient. This comes from two Greek words, long-tempered and suffering. This is so characteristic of God, who is merciful and gracious and slow to anger. I remember how helpful this characteristic would have been about 4 years ago, and I'll share with you what happened. Our family had gone to Boston, and we went to see a show, and we parked in one of those, you know, multi-tiered parking lots. And of course, at the end of the night, everyone is rushing to their car in the garage, and everyone wants to get out of the city as soon as they can. The only way to accomplish this with so many cars is through patience. Well, there was anything but patience in that garage. So we are in our car. We are in a long, long line. You can hear cars honking. And all of a sudden, a car beside us pulls up to about an inch from our car. He was not going to miss his opportunity to cut in front of us as soon as that traffic moved. Not only that, but there was a woman who literally got out of her car. She came up to us, I'm not kidding you, and she said, you know, if you could just back up a little bit and move over there, we would be able to get out. And I remember thinking to myself, and what is it that you think we're trying to do? Patience. It is not one of my virtues. That's definitely in my prayer journal, in my list, asking the Lord to help me. Patience. Long-suffering to endure irritants without allowing one's anger to lash out in retaliation. Love is kind. Now, patience involves restraint. Being kind is an action word, right? Helpful, doing good, stepping forward, sharing a burden, or meeting a need. Love does not envy. This is an intense desire that we have for something that belongs to someone else. The old green monster, jealousy. Jealousy and love are like oil and water. I remember hearing about a woman who in her prayer time was kind of just giving a general confession to the Lord, and she kind of felt the Lord asking her, you know what, you need to be really specific with me about what you're confessing. And as it turned out, the Lord wanted her to confess and repent that she had been very envious of a friend who received a blessing. Love does not boast. Love is not proud. This is the person who is focused on the welfare of the other person, cannot at the same time be self-centered and be boasting and be proud. The person who loves another with agape love will try and lift that person up rather than boast about his or her own accomplishments. Love does not dishonor others. This has to do with behaving in an indecent or unbecoming manner. Love is not self-seeking. The person who loves another with agape love cannot at the same time be selfish or demanding of his or her own rights. Love is not easily angered and does not keep a record of wrongs. A beautiful illustration of this is there was a man named Coleman, and his car was damaged by a woman who had passed him too closely on the highway and had sideswiped his car. When they pulled over to the side of the road to wait for the police, the woman literally broke down into tears. It was her fault, and she knew it, but she didn't know how she was going to face her husband because she was sure that he was going to be irate because it was a new car. So she opened up the glove compartment to, you know, take out the paperwork, and in it she found an envelope with a note that said this: in case of accident, remember, honey, it's you I love and not the car. I love that. Love does not delight in evil. The best example that I can give of you is this: when you hear of maybe somebody who is bragging and who's very, very proud, and then all of a sudden they get humbled by something, and there's kind of that part in you that's kind of, a little bit happy, like they got what they deserve. Or when someone gossips with us and shares some information that really we shouldn't be hearing, but it's kind of like there's a part of us that's like really glad to hear it, and there's a part of us that maybe even wants to pass that on. Love rejoices with the truth. This is about behavior that is true to godly standards, upright behavior. The one who loves with agape love will not rejoice with another's downfall, but will rejoice when the other person does what is right in God's sight. And Paul ends this section with, love always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. So the one who loves with agape love is optimistic, is going to believe the best rather than the worst about someone else, does not give up easily on others, and perseveres in face of hardships. And I love how Paul sums up his writing. He says, but the greatest of these is love. And why is love the greatest and the most excellent way? Because it is the core of the image of God. Love that gave us salvation, even though we didn't deserve it. 1 John 4:8 says, whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. And when we love the way Paul describes it, we are most like God. And that is the most excellent way. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful, beautiful passage. And I know that so many of us have probably heard it multiple times. Church, weddings, maybe funerals. And of course, there's that tendency to want to, oh, I know that. So we kind of tune it out. But Lord, I pray we didn't do that this morning. And if that did happen, maybe just a little bit, thank you that we can go and read it later and meditate on it. Because God, this is such a powerful, powerful message. And Paul was not writing this to brides and grooms. He was writing it to the church. And this church was struggling with something very, very specific, with all that was going on with the sacred prostitutes. There was a lot of confusion about what love is, but also, Lord, they were arguing about the spiritual gifts, and they were trying to say that one gift was better than another, and holding people up higher than they should have because they had a particular gift over another. And just so eloquently and so beautifully, Paul shows that those gifts are absolutely worthless if love is not the motivator behind them. And then he so beautifully gives us a description, really, of what love is and what it isn't. And Father, I pray that in the coming weeks or months that we would take this list and really make it a prayer to you, Lord, to help us work on those areas where we need to work on them, especially in our relationships, Lord, because boy, does our world need love more than it ever has. And the only way we can illustrate and demonstrate that love is through Holy Spirit working through us. So Father, may this list, if you will, become our heartfelt prayer. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I thank you so much for joining me. I hope you have a blessed week. Go in peace. Amen. Bring back.